In a previous video, we discussed the AT&T Long Lines microwave radio network, which carried many of America's long-distance phone calls and TV programs for decades between the 1940s and the 1980s. In this video, we're going to focus on a critical piece of the system, the waveguides. Waveguides are hollow metal tubes that carry radio waves. Early experimentation, around 1900, revealed that a waveguide's diameter had to be roughly the wavelength of the signal, at minimum. Put simply, a signal with too large of a wavelength would not fit through the tube. This limitation made waveguides impractical for the radio frequencies used at the time. For example, a 20 MHz signal has a wavelength of about 15 meters, or 50 feet. Thus, the idea of waveguides got shelved until the 1930s, when Bell Labs and MIT started experimenting with them. With advancements in electronics and growing demand for telecommunications, it was clear that the widespread use of higher radio frequencies was on the horizon. AT&T's first microwave communications network, launched in the 1940s, operated at frequencies around 4 GHz, which corresponds to a wavelength of 3 inches. Waveguides had finally become practical for large-scale telecommunications. So, why would one use these hollow metal tubes, which require careful installation and alignment, as opposed to something simpler, like coaxial cable? And the answer is that waveguides have lower loss, especially at high frequencies. Coaxial cable is widely used for frequencies under about 1 GHz, including cable systems and the first few generations of cellular technology. However, the losses in coaxial cable get unreasonably high at frequencies in the gigahertz range. An application requiring a 50-foot run from the comms bunker to the top of the tower, for example, would be served much better with a waveguide than with a coaxial cable. It's also very important to note that waveguide technology doesn't just carry signals, it can filter them too. So, for example, if you need to select one radio channel and to reject the two adjacent radio channels, this can be done with waveguide technology. The very crude idea is that only certain frequencies will fit through certain holes. In the electrical world, waveguide inserts can be modeled by circuit elements. Numerous types of filters, combiners, and dividers have been created for the waveguide world. Initially, AT&T's TD2 system used 6 channels. Note that 3 channels would be used in each direction, such as shown here. Each tower would need to receive different frequencies than it transmitted, as the highly directional antennas still did not provide sufficient isolation alone. At each repeater station, waveguide filters had to isolate each channel independently before the signal could be amplified. Many of the capacity improvements to AT&T's microwave system can be attributed to improvements in the waveguide and antenna technology. In 1951, new waveguide filters using ferrite cores were developed, allowing the number of channels to be doubled. One of the coolest innovations to the long lines antenna system, however, was polarization. The rudimentary idea is that one wave oscillates horizontally and the other wave oscillates vertically. If the antennas and waveguide system can preserve this perpendicularity, the signals can be isolated with special polarized filters. In practice, this isolation is not perfect. However, new polarized systems started to roll out in 1955, allowing the number of channels to be doubled once again. Furthermore, this new antenna system was designed to be compatible with 2 bands, effectively providing another doubling of capacity. So, that's a glimpse into the waveguides of AT&T Long Lines. Now, where else has this technology been used? Well, since waveguides exhibit lower loss than coaxial cables, they have been used in many applications where the frequency is high enough to make the tubes a reasonable size. A great example is radar. Developed initially for the military, and now widely used for weather and commercial applications, radar typically uses frequencies in the gigahertz range, making it a prime waveguide application. An interesting piece to note is that waveguides can be made in different shapes. While rectangular waveguides are the most common in general, circular waveguides are widely used for radar applications due to their ability to rotate symmetrically. Satellites and satellite dishes are another prime waveguide application, as they also typically operate in the gigahertz range. As we learned from my previous video, the AT&T Long Lines microwave system was made obsolete by satellite and fiber optic technology. Well, a fiber optic strand is technically a waveguide. The propagation medium is no longer air, but glass. AT&T initially called the new technology light guide. Today, the same 3.7 to 4.2 GHz band used by long lines is used for 5G technologies. Instead of a hollow tube waveguide from the house to the antenna, a powered fiber optic cable is used, which connects directly to a radio with integrated antennas, converting the light to radio frequency. Waveguides are still commonly used in industrial, scientific, and medical applications. Miniaturization of electronics, however, has allowed phased array antenna technologies to replace certain applications of waveguides. Phased arrays contain many antenna elements, with each connected to electronics that can adjust the phase and amplitude of the waveform entering the element. This technology allows the beam to be aimed nearly instantaneously, without motors. The latest commercial applications of phased arrays are 5G antennas and low Earth orbit satellite technologies, like Starlink. So, I hope you enjoyed this video, and as always, I enjoy getting technical comments and questions. It's not easy to cover the history of waveguides in less than 10 minutes, so let me know if there's anything important I left out.